We're going to start with really talking about the smallest system. Now, the smallest system is where you've got, quite simply, a master station, and that's all we have. Now, there are several different models that we have available. We're going to start with the 4206. The 4206 is probably the most popular model. It has 32 channels and 6 dimmers. The 4106 has 6 channels and 6 dimmers. The 4104 has 4 channels and 4 dimmers. The 4006 has 0 channels and 6 dimmers. That's the model I was talking about earlier that we use for system expansion. Finally, the 4200 has 32 channels and 0 dimmers. Now you might be asking, what do we do, or why would we want to have more channels than we have dimmers in the box? Quite simply, that's so that we can control other things that might be in the network. For example, if we have a 4206 and a 4006, I've got 2 devices with 6 channels each, but the single device, the 4206, is what's going to be controlling all of them. And we'll talk about an example of that in a few minutes. Let's for a minute though go back to what I'm talking about, the basic system, and let's presume for a minute that this is a 4104. Now remember, the 4104 has 4 channels and 4 dimmers. One of the most common uses of that device is in a conference room. Now, in the smallest system, I'd have my 4104. It would have coming into it a single 120 volt 20 amp circuit. Coming out of it, it would have 4 individual 120 volt circuits. Now, if you think about the ratings on these circuits, they are all rated for a max 1000 watts per output circuit or per dimmer, max 1920 watts continuous for the entire device, and max 1200 watts per side. Now, if you look at the back of the device, you'll know that there's output dimmers on the left and the right side. And what we mean by saying each side is the left side cannot exceed 1200 watts, the right side cannot exceed 1200 watts. This 1920 watts max means you're never gonna see more than 1920 watts coming in the input. And of course, the per dimmer rating says that each one of these devices here cannot exceed 1000 watts each. So the smallest system would be just a single master station with power coming in and power coming out. Now, let's look at a couple variations. What happens if we're using an entry station in the system? Well, in that system, we're going to have a master station. Let's stick with the 4104 for a minute. It's still going to have power going in and individual controlled circuits going out. I'm going to add to that an entry station. For simplicity, let's just use one that does scene 1 and off. That's one of the entry station models that we have. Now, that device does not have any power going to it directly, but what it has is if we run that luminet cable in between it. Now, one of our preferred cables to run is Belden 1502R. Now, one of the things we like about 1502R is it has one pair for data and one pair for power. So what's really happening on this system is we've got power that's coming from the 4104 and powering the station, and data that's coming back on it. Now, we call that data is what we call luminet, which is why we call that luminet power. One of the things we're seeing quite common in the field is the need to control load types that are 1 to 10 volt or 0 to 10 volt controlled loads. We're seeing this a lot in commercial applications like office spaces where they want to use LED lighting. And we all know that you get some of the best dimming control when you're using 1 to 10 volt as a control signal as compared to trying to just do 2-wire devices. Remember that the Dimensions 4000 are all 2-wire outputs. So quite often what we will do is we'll use a power extender to convert the 0 to 120 to 1 to 10 volt. So what does that look like when you're doing that with dimensions 4000? Well, you'll have the master station, and just for example, we'll use a 4104. You have your power coming in, your output power going out. Instead of going direct to the loads on these outputs like we normally would do, what we'll do is we'll come over here and put one or more PE300s. PE stands for power extender. The 300 is the model that converts 0 to 120 control. So we've got 0 to 120 control in here. And it converts it into a relay. So that's just going to be switched on, off only. And plus 1 to 10 volt control on the output, and of course common. So you have two wires, 0 to 120 going in, and four wire, 1 to 10 volt, low voltage DC control, and a switched relay for on-off power going out. And this is how we handle the connection to any 1 to 10 volt controlled load. Right now, the most common we're seeing this for is LEDs with 1 to 10 volt drivers. However, you also use this for anything that's a 1 to 10 volt controlled ballast, like an advanced Mark 7 ballast. All right, so I've showed you what we would consider to be the smallest system, and I've shown you how to add an entry station. Well, let's look at a couple more things, like what does an auxiliary input? Well, the auxiliary input is really on the back of the device, the aux input, and it has three wires that are on that terminal. Two of them are providing power, so plus voltage in common. The third one is the signal coming back into the device. Now, most commonly what this is used for is it's connected up to a Leviton aux sensor that's detecting whether people are in the room. And it quite simply gets programmed as when people walk into the room, typically will trigger scene one. When people have been gone from the room for say a half hour, it'll trigger the off scene. And Andy will talk to you about how to program that later on in this tape. That's probably the single most common use. The second most common use for that is when you're connecting it up to a security system or a fire alarm system. And in that case, what you want to do is trigger the lights on to full when you go into that fire or security situation. In that area, you also want to lock the user interface so that nobody can make changes until that security or fire system goes away and you go back into normal operation. And again, Andy will walk you through exactly how to do that later on in this presentation. For now, I just want to let you know that this is how you connect up to it. So at this point, we've talked about the smallest system where there was a master station only and you have power in and dimmers coming out. We talked about how you add an entry station and how this is the luminette wire in between. In reality, you could add multiple entry stations. You don't just have to add one. And again, that's just luminette running in between them. You also could add another dimensions 4006 for remote dimmers. And that again has power going in and individual dimmers going out. And of course the 4006 is really a six dimmer device, so we would have up to six dimmers on the output. There's lots of different ways to put this system together that all can be custom tailored to your specific application and what's needed at the job site. So what you really want to do when you're starting a job is start by learning what's been installed, where it's been installed, verify your connectivity and your wiring. All of that's got to be done before you'll ever have a successful commissioning opportunity. Last thing that I'll mention is this might be a system that's running a small restaurant or a conference room. However, in some applications, we'll take multiples of these systems and tie them together, and they could be tied together to all sorts of things. For example, we could tie it to an NPC DLR. Luminette would be on this side. Coming out the other side, we could have Ethernet that's going to a BACnet IP system. Now that's a little bit more of an advanced functionality, and if you have that, you're pretty much guaranteed. We've done drawings for you through our applications engineering department that show you how all this happens, but that's certainly a possibility. You also could use an architecture like this through an MPC DLR when you're doing Luma graphics control, or rather control through a PC. That's another place we see things that like this that go together. Things to look out for when you're doing larger systems like this is you absolutely want to make sure that everything has a unique ID. Every device on the network must have a unique LumaNet ID. That should go without saying at this point in time, but again, I couldn't reinforce that enough. If you have two devices on the network with the same ID, your network will get unstable very, very quickly. So definitely look for that. Also, note that all of the dimmers in these devices are fully network dimmers. So anything, if you set, for example, out of the box, the first dimmer is channel one in all of these devices. It doesn't matter where that channel one command comes in. It could come in from BACnet, Luma Graphics, D8000, D4000, the AV interface. It goes on down the list that anywhere that channel one command originates from will control all channel ones on the network. So, if you have multiple systems on the network that are all interconnected together in separate rooms, you also have to ensure that they have unique channel numbers. Because if you don't have unique channel numbers, you'll have stations in room A controlling dimmers in room B, and most of the time that's undesirable. So just watch out for that. Again, in most of those situations, not all of them, but in most of those situations, you're gonna have applications drawings from us that show you exactly how that goes together. So there should be nothing hidden from you on that.
To learn more about Leviton products, please visit leviton.com.